We have this idea that science is about precision and certainty, that we can run a scientific experiment and prove something beyond all doubt. But in reality, the opposite is true. Most, if not all, sciences deal in uncertainty. In biomedical science, biology, medicine, public health, we're never 100% sure. Instead, the scientific process is about approximation, a gradual reduction of uncertainty. This is very jarring for a lot of people because it clashes with our expectations. I'll give you a real-world example. Red meat. Totally non-controversial topic, right? Forget for a second whether you love or hate red meat. Push all of that to the side. Pretend we're a team of scientists trying to objectively figure out this question. What is the health impact of consuming red meat? To make it more specific, let's say on cardiovascular disease. Now, we're starting from square one, so we know nothing and we have zero certainty. So we start by studying a group of people. Let's say the population of a city. For example, this study found that higher consumption of red meat was associated with an increased risk of coronary heart disease. And this one found increased risk of death due to different causes, including heart disease, was associated with red meat intake. So just with that information, what's our level of certainty regarding the effect of red meat on cardiovascular disease? It's very low. We're slightly better off than we were a minute ago by learning all of this, but not by much, because there's just too many loose ends. For example, red meat includes bacon, salami, beef jerky, and steaks. And those are very different beasts. So maybe processed meat is a problem, but steaks are totally fine. So we want to look at those things separately. So the first study we saw a minute ago found higher intake of total red meat or red meat excluding processed meat. Both were significantly associated with higher risk of coronary heart disease. And the second study also found both processed and unprocessed red meat were associated with higher risk of death of multiple causes, including heart disease. Okay, so that adds some information. The associations seem to hold up with unprocessed red meat specifically, but we still have a lot of loose ends. For example, these two studies we've been looking at, are they just a fluke? Maybe they're just outliers. So we want to run this type of analysis on multiple populations and average everything. That's called a meta-analysis. Here's a recent one from last year. They included 13 studies, and they found higher consumption of unprocessed red meat was associated with 9% higher risk of ischemic heart disease. Now, these estimates are always for a specific amount. In this case, it's for each 50 grams eaten daily. And 50 grams is about 1.7 ounce. So about a quarter of a full-size 8-ounce steak. So averaging out a bunch of studies confirms the general direction of association, which increases our confidence slightly, but it's far from a slam dunk. For example, the overall effect, although significant, is modest, at least for a relatively small amount of meat. I told you this video is about uncertainty, so we always want to ask ourselves, am I being shown a pixel or the big picture? If I zoom out, does the picture change? It's the same with these videos. You want to continuously ask yourself, is somebody else showing an even broader picture with even more nuance? Okay, we still have tons of confounders in the mix. For example, people who eat more red meat also tend to exercise less, smoke more, drink more, be more overweight, etc. So maybe those factors are the real problem, and red meat is just an innocent bystander. So in order to address this question, studies adjust for those factors. For example, that second study we looked at with mortality, their results were adjusted for sex, age, ethnicity, education, health at baseline, history of heart disease, stroke, diabetes, and cancer, smoking, BMI, physical activity, alcohol, and total calories, among other factors. Interestingly, they found the associations with red meat were actually stronger after other risk factors were removed from the equation. The mortality associated with red meat was stronger in non-smokers or former smokers, in people with normal BMI, and in non or mild alcohol drinkers. So this is the opposite of what we would expect if red meat was an innocent bystander. The effect is stronger in a clean background, in healthy, lean people who don't smoke or drink much. The authors explain, the effects were more pronounced in the absence of other important risk factors. For example, the risk associated with red meat was weaker among current smokers. These people already have higher risk to begin with from smoking, so the relative contribution of red meat to this already higher risk will seem smaller. So these results argue against the idea that red meat is just an innocent bystander, and that the links to disease are just due to smoking more or exercising less. The data is pointing in the opposite direction. Okay, so maybe tobacco and booze don't explain it, but what about junk food? Maybe the problem is the soda and the bun, and the patty is just getting a bad rep by association. How do we untangle those factors? For example, this study asked if ultra-processed food and animal foods, including red meat, have independent health effects. They found that ultra-processed foods, aka junk food, were associated with more total death even when all animal foods were taken out of the equation, adjusted statistically. So the harm associated with junk food can't simply be pinned on animal foods. Ultra-processed food seems to have an independent effect. Similarly, they found that red meat was also associated with more total death after ultra-processed food was taken out of the equation, suggesting the association between red meat and disease can't simply be pinned on junk food. So that's one approach to this question. Another approach is to look at overall dietary patterns. Similar to the logic we saw before, if red meat is an innocent bystander, and if the real culprit is junk food, then we might expect red meat to look less harmful in the context of a healthy diet, with more fruits and vegetables, less soda, less trans fats, and less added salt. But this study found the exact opposite. The association between unprocessed red meat intake and cardiovascular disease was stronger in participants consuming a higher quality diet, with those characteristics we just listed. So this makes it less likely that it's all just due to junk food, because the red meat without the junk food, if anything, is showing stronger associations. Okay, but everything so far is just correlations, just association, just epidemiology. So what other types of evidence do we have? Well, analysis have shown the increased risks associated with red meat may be partly accounted for by heme iron, which is very concentrated in red meat. So that's a candidate mechanism for the effect of red meat. Now, we want to be very careful with mechanisms because they get used and abused. Mechanisms never replace outcome evidence, actual evidence of cardiovascular disease in humans. But if they align with the outcome evidence, then they can be ancillary. They can increase our confidence a little bit. Okay, what about randomized controlled trials, RCTs? Aren't those the big dogs when it comes to data? Well, most of the large randomized controlled trials in nutrition that lasted for several years changed entire dietary patterns, not a single food. For example, Lyon and Predimed looked at Mediterranean diets, which are typically low in red meat, while the Women's Health Initiative lowered dietary fat in general, including lowering red meat by about 1.5 servings per week. Predimed reported 30% lower cardiovascular risk, Lyon reported 50 to 70% lower, and the Women's Health Initiative reported no significant effect. Although when they followed the volunteers past the trial for a total of 18 years observationally, there was a significant association between higher intake of unprocessed red meat and risk of dying from cardiovascular disease. The bottom line for me, these large trials looking at entire dietary patterns are pretty inconclusive when it comes to red meat specifically, because they change 1,000 things. So how can we know what is or isn't caused by red meat, among all the other factors? Okay, what if we ran an RCT that swapped only red meat? That would nail it, right? Well, studies have done that. This one, for example, for 3 days every week, they swapped red meat with legumes, like lentils, beans, and chickpeas, while leaving overall calories constant. And the legume-based diet decreased blood glucose, insulin, triglycerides, and LDL cholesterol. Okay, that raises our confidence a little bit. Is it 100% yet? Nope, why not? It's a randomized control trial. Number one, it only looked at serum markers, not actual disease outcomes. So do these short-term improvements result in actual lower risk of disease long-term? Maybe, but this trial can't prove it. Also, the population they looked at was overweight diabetics. Would we see the same thing in healthy, fit 25-year-olds? This study can't prove that. Also, maybe it's not the red meat that's harmful. Maybe it's the beans that are really helpful. Did I mention uncertainty? Okay, do we have any more data that can raise our certainty? Most foods that are rich in saturated fat, like fatty meats and butter, raise ApoB. ApoB is a measure of the lipoprotein particles in our blood that cause plaque, heart disease. Okay, so that points in the same general direction and gives us a little bit more confidence. Why doesn't that nail it, though? If red meat, at least red meat with any fat, raises ApoB and ApoB causes heart disease, how is that not 100%? Well, red meat could raise ApoB and ApoB could raise risk, but red meat could do something else physiologically that offsets risk, and the net effect of the food could be neutral, or even positive, theoretically. You see where we're going with all of this? There's no such thing as a perfect experiment. If we look at things objectively, every piece of evidence has blind spots, regardless of how rigorous it is. It's not a flaw, it's a feature of scientific experiments. So looking at a study and pointing out the blind spots is trivial. It doesn't even require any specific insight. Don't get me wrong, study quality matters. There are more and less rigorous RCTs, and the same for epidemiology. So we go through each study carefully, and the most rigorous ones rank higher. But the idea that any limitation or blind spot makes a study useless is a misunderstanding, because they all have them, without exception. Now, sometimes people say nutrition science is weak because it's all epidemiology. Nothing could be farther from the truth. There are thousands of randomized control trials in nutrition. I just showed you several. The real epiphany is that RCTs, although they're abundant, are also imperfect. This does not mean that we can't ever know anything, so we just give up and wait for the perfect experiment to come along. It's the exact opposite of that. The perfect experiment will never come. Confidence around a scientific question is built not by finding the perfect pixel, but by stepping back and looking at the big picture. Preponderance of evidence. When we see reproducibility, especially different experimental approaches pointing in the same direction, that raises confidence. Sometimes we confuse not knowing something with 100% certainty with not knowing anything at all. But of course, those are vastly different. Uncertainty is normal. It's integral to all life decisions. Where we go to school, who we marry, what job we take. We gather information to increase our confidence, but it's never 100% guarantee. It's always an educated guess. In fact, here's some more uncertainty around red meat. Dose matters. Risk seems to get larger above 100 grams per day average intake of unprocessed red meat. Replacement matters. Cutting back on steaks to replace with bacon or ultra-processed foods, refined grains, is not a good move. And different cuts of meat can have very different effects. The BOLD trial showed it's possible to add red meat to a diet while improving lipids, as long as total saturated fat is reduced, which they achieved by using very lean cuts. So this might be useful information for people who choose to include some red meat in their diet while still keeping their cardiovascular risk factors under control. Okay, what about grass-fed beef and wild game? The idea is that because those animals live in more natural conditions, are leaner, and aren't fed grains or stuffed with antibiotics, they might be more health-promoting. Some of those meats have also been shown to contain more omega-3s. But at the end of the day, what we want to know are the actual health effects in people eating these products. And there is surprisingly little data on that. For example, this study found some undesirable changes to lipid profile when people ate grass-fed meat compared to grain-fed. For example, higher triglycerides. Although the study wasn't quite isocaloric, people on grass-fed ate a bit more calories overall, so it's hard to interpret their results. And this trial randomized volunteers to grass-fed or grain-fed meat and dairy, and found no difference in lipids, glucose metabolism, or body composition between the two groups. If future data shows a lower risk of disease long-term on grass-fed or wild-caught meat, great. Until we have actual evidence, the only rigorous thing we can say is we don't know. Okay, more uncertainty. There are pros and cons to red meat. For example, this study found that unprocessed red meat was associated with ischemic heart disease, diverticulosis, and colon polyps, among other things, but less iron deficiency anemia. So is red meat good or bad? Depends on context. For a population in a developing country with an impoverished diet, low in amino acids, low in micronutrients, adding some red meat is probably a good thing. For the typical overfed, hypercholesterolemic Western population, replacing some of the red meat with some fish or plant protein would be a health-promoting move. For an elderly, frail population with low appetite with nutrient insufficiencies, adding some red meat is probably a good thing. All about context. And there's always individual variability. Some people can handle more than others. One rule of thumb is if your cholesterol and your ApoB are golden, you're probably doing all right. And family history can also give us some hints. Scientists have to bear all of these factors in mind. That's why food recommendations by professional scientific organizations often sound vague. Favor a dietary pattern high in fruits and vegetables and moderate or low in red meat. They all say essentially the same thing. Notice that no reputable organization says you have to have zero, and nobody recommends eating piles of it. And of course, this type of advice annoys everybody, because usually half the people want meat to be poison for humans, and the other half want it to be completely risk-free no matter the amount. But the science doesn't support either of those scenarios, which just ends up upsetting everyone. Now, wait a minute. What if we run the perfect randomized control trial? We take like a million people, we randomly split them, we give half of them a pile of red meat every single day, the other half, no red meat, and we follow them for like 20 years. That would nail it, right? Extremely difficult to get volunteers to stick to the diets for that long, getting funding, getting an ethics committee to approve a study like that. I doubt we'll ever see one. But even if it was done, how much difference would it really make? It would raise our confidence a bit more, sure. But it still wouldn't be 100%. How do you know they stuck to the diet for that long? You can't trap people in a research facility for decades, so you have to let them go about their lives and then just ask them what they ate. Self-report. How do you know everything else stayed the same? Maybe the meatless group got motivated by that change and decided to also smoke a little bit less and exercise a little bit more. So you gotta ask them. Self-report again. These are the same caveats of epidemiology, which is why some researchers say the longer your RCT, the more it looks like epidemiology. The longer you go, the less control you have. If you study overweight pre-diabetics, it doesn't apply to healthy people. If you look at super fit individuals, it doesn't apply to most Westerners. How's the meat cooked? If it's grilled or fried, then maybe the problem is not the meat. Maybe it's the chemicals that get formed at high temperature. If it's carefully boiled or steamed, then it doesn't apply to how most people eat it. What are the macros of the diet around the meat? If it's high fat, it doesn't apply to people on intermediate fat. If it's high carb, it doesn't apply to low carb. If you go low carb, it's say 10% of carbs, it doesn't apply to people on very low carb or keto. If you go keto at 5% of carbs, somebody will say, the problem is not the meat, it's the 5% of carbs you left in there. And if you do zero carb, then it doesn't apply to 99.99% of the population. I think you get the point. There's no such thing as the perfect experiment. The perfect experiment is an abstract concept talked about by people who don't run experiments. And this gets us to another very common question, which is saying that the risk factor doesn't apply to my specific characteristics. Studies of tobacco usually look at populations that eat worse than me, exercise less, and have higher cholesterol. So I'm just gonna keep smoking like a chimney until science can prove to me that tobacco is bad specifically for somebody with very low cholesterol, who is 6'1" and does yoga on Mondays. I can discount every risk factor known to men with this logic, but of course this misses the point. Science is never gonna reflect my exact physiological characteristics and my exact diet and my exact circumstances. That's not the goal. Tobacco is an accepted risk factor because it's been shown over and over in different populations, different lines of evidence supported, and it survived many adjustments. There's never been a 20-year randomized controlled trial for tobacco, or for trans fats, or for diabetes, or for junk food. And yet, we accept all of them, we take them for granted, and we assume they apply to us until proven otherwise. As annoying as it is, science can never give us 100% certainty. What it's very good at doing, though, is giving us crucial pieces of information so we can make educated decisions in a world packed with uncertainty. Here's more details on saturated fat, and here's more on ApoB. Let me know your thoughts below. Be well. Take care. Bye.